Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Sharlin. I am the chief neurologist and owner of Sharlin Health and Neurology Functional Medicine. I want to welcome you to this video today. We're going to talk a little bit about my regenerate pillar and a little bit about stem cell medicine as well. I've been creating a series of videos that focuses on what we call the five pillars at Sharlin Health and Neurology, and this is our way of approaching problems that affect the nervous system, that affect you. What do I mean by that? We start with correctly identifying the problem. Then we want to investigate the root causes. Then we're going to help you to integrate all those root causes identified into a single cohesive plan that you're able to execute. We also have a restore pillar that focuses on the importance of hormones and brain health and ultimately helps you become the best version of yourself. And finally, we have the regenerate pillar that focuses on our proprietary stem cell approach using what are called medicinal signaling cells or mesenchymal stem cells. They're the same thing. I will elaborate on that a little bit more in a moment. I have another laptop open in front of me. I'm going to be using some notes as I go along. This is a fairly complicated topic, but I'll condense it down for you and hopefully make it easy to understand. I have a more detailed presentation I'll also be putting together and invite you to join me on that pre-recorded webinar in the near future. So to start off with, it's important to understand that we are in the age of cellular therapy. Cellular therapy or biological therapies are used throughout neurology and rheumatology, as well as cancer treatments. Sometimes these approaches involve manipulation of the immune system to, say, attack cancer by focusing on your own immune cells and the behavior of your immune cells to go after the cancer rather than killing the cancer itself. Sometimes it focuses on treatment with a variety of antibodies. These antibodies are very similar to the antibodies your own immune cells produce, and they act like a very precise key that goes into a lock because they can be designed to target highly specific areas on a protein that then in turn affect how the cells behave. This might, for example, treat a disease like Alzheimer's disease, or in other cases, shut down migraines from where they're starting. Finally, we can use cells that are introduced in the body, and that's where stem cell treatment comes in. These stem cells are normally found in places like the bone marrow and fat tissue in the body. And when there is injury and inflammation, this is our first line of defense. These cells come out, they are anti-inflammatory, and they participate in tissue repair. So let's look at this in a little bit more detail. What is a stem cell? Well, a stem cell is a type of cell that is a non-specific or non-specialized cell in terms of its function. They have the capacity for self-renewal, and this gives the rise to more stem cells. They're capable of differentiating into different lineages, different types of cells under appropriate conditions. And basically, there are two types of stem cells. There are embryonic and non-embryonic stem cells. And our focus is going to be to talk about the non-embryonic stem cells. But first, I need to give you a few definitions. You'll hear these terms throughout discussions of stem cell medicine, published in blogs and talked about in podcasts or summit recordings or journal articles, of course. So it's important to have somewhat of an idea of what these words actually mean. The first two words are autologous versus allogeneic. Autologous or auto means self. So the stem cells and autologous transplants come from the person who will actually get the transplant. In other words, the patient is the donor. Allo, or out from allogeneic, means other. So that the stem cells in allogeneic transplants come from a person or an animal other than the patient, either a matched or an unrelated donor. At Charlotte Health Regeneration Center, one of my sister companies, if you will, we only focus on autologous stem cell transplants. There's another term, Institutional Review Board. This is an independent ethics committee, an ethical review board or research ethics board that is responsible for reviewing the methods proposed for a research study to ensure that they are ethical. We see IRB approved as an expression thrown around a lot on various websites and companies that promote stem cell treatment. So it's very important when you hear the term IRB approved that you understand that this does not mean FDA approved. This just means that an institutional review board has gone over the protocols and the ethics, if you will, of performing a study, right? So this is still research, this is still investigational, and given their stamp of approval to move forward with the research study. Again, very important to understand that IRB approved is not equivalent to FDA approved. Another important term is investigational new drug, or IND. Investigational new drug, this refers to a drug or a biological compound that's been approved for use in a clinical trial to investigate its safety and/or efficacy. So when we use the term IND status, that means that it's been approved for use in specific clinical trials, okay? So if you have IND status for a study, for a compound that you're investigating, you can't use that in a completely unrelated study. You have to have separate approval for each study that you are doing. There are stem cell companies that have IND status for their product to treat COVID-related lung injury. That does not mean that their treatment is approved on an investigational basis to treat Parkinson's disease, for example. Now, there are different phases of clinical trials, and we'll run through those because, again, I'm most interested in you guys getting accurate information when you look at websites, when you hear about clinical trials, when you read a blog, when you listen to a podcast, when you listen to a summit speaker, because sometimes the language can be very confusing. And I honestly believe that sometimes it's intentionally confusing, and that's the problem. So, what are the phases of a clinical trial? Clinical trials ultimately are about getting products out to market to you so they get commercialized under the US healthcare system, right? So you, for example, see drug advertisements on television, and those are now available because they're FDA approved, but they've gone through all of these steps. So it starts out with a preclinical phase where the drug is being studied in animal models or in cell, models in the laboratory, in petri dishes or fruit flies or mice or, and so forth. There is still ongoing animal research, although, of course, some of that has been limited in more recent years by animal rights advocates. There are phase one studies. Phase one studies are not really efficacy studies at all. A phase one study most commonly involves men who are generally in the range of 18 to 25 years old, who are very healthy. So, why men? Why that age? Well, because they're going to be receiving a drug. We don't want to give the drug at this stage to anyone who could even potentially become pregnant or who has other health-related issues going on. And the only purpose of a phase one study, generally speaking, is to get some early safety data and to study what happens when we administer the drug in the body, meaning how quickly does it get to the bloodstream? How quickly does it get to the target tissue? These are called pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic studies. They really don't have anything to do with the effectiveness of the drug to treat a given condition. It might help with what is the dose that we're going to use in a future clinical trial to treat that condition, but initially, this is just healthy men ages 18 to 25. We then have phase two studies, and I'll link that to phase three because they're very similar. A phase two study is kind of a test study. It's a smaller scale phase three study. There is an element of efficacy now, so we are treating the target population. Maybe that's people who have relapsing, remitting multiple sclerosis, for example. We're still going to get some safety data. We always collect safety data. Usually, they're what are called primary outcome measures, the main thing that needs to be studied, and then there are secondary measures that are added on. The phase three study then is the larger version of the phase two study. That's the big study that's going to be used if the treatment is deemed successful or effective, and then the company that owns that product is going to submit their data to the FDA for approval. There are also phase four studies, and these involve what are called post-marketing studies. So we're gathering additional data about the drug or treatment, but the drug is already approved and out there in the marketplace. Now, I have seen stem cell trials where subjects are told that this is a research trial, but they're actually being asked to pay for their treatment. And the FDA generally frowns upon subjects being asked to pay for their own participation in a clinical trial. That's not to say that it can't ever happen. There are some specific guidelines that do allow for this. However, in general, if you are being asked to pay for participation in a research trial, you should be very suspicious. You need to find out more information about why you're being asked to pay. In general, most large clinical trials are funded by the study sponsor. That would be the company that owns the patented product. So, in the world of stem cell medicine, that could be BrainStorm Cell Therapeutics that has the NurOwn product. It's a mesenchymal stem product that is being studied to treat conditions like ALS, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's disease, and multiple sclerosis. So, when you go to a website where they talk about, hey, we've got this product and this is our pipeline, a lot of times you can look up and see where is that product in the pipeline. And take the information I just shared with you about IRB approval and phase of clinical trial and see, because if something is in phase one trial, remember, that's not even being studied at that stage to treat the condition that might interest you. That's just a safety trial and what we call a pharmacokinetic or pharmacodynamic trial. So, how are stem cells regulated by the Food and Drug Administration? Well, in the United States, cellular therapies are regulated by the FDA's Office of Cellular Tissue and Gene Therapies within the FDA Center for Biologics Evaluation and Research. And the FDA distinguishes what they refer to as 351 products versus 361 products. Now, currently, the only stem cell treatments approved by the Food and Drug Administration are 351 products. And they're regulated as drugs or biological therapies. And that would be things like vaccines or NurOwn and monoclonal antibodies used to treat various conditions. They have to go through the clinical trial approval pathway that I just explained to you. We have 351 products that are approved to treat things like certain cancers and disorders of blood and the immune system. So the FDA has not approved any exosome, if you've heard of that term, any exosome product for any use whatsoever. So if you have a practitioner in the United States offering to give you exosomes, please understand that is a direct violation of the FDA regulations. Now, by contrast, the term HCTPs refers to human cells, tissue, and tissue-based products. The FDA regulates HCTPs as 361 products under 21 CFR 1271.10A. Whew, that's a lot. While 361 products must meet specific criteria by the FDA to be designated as HCTPs, they are not required to go through the clinical trial approval pathway. These criteria are what distinguishes the HCTPs from drugs and biological therapies. So let's talk about mesenchymal stem cells because they fall under that 361 category. Now, mesenchymal stem cells can be isolated from various tissues such as umbilical cord, endometrium, including polyps, menstrual blood, bone marrow, and fat tissue. And mesenchymal stem cells are multipotent, meaning they can differentiate into a variety of different cell types, including bone cells, cartilage cells, and muscle cells, and fat cells that give rise to marrow adipose tissue. But the differentiation of or the diff but the differentiation potential of mesenchymal stem cells is not actually what makes them attractive from a clinical perspective. So a little history. Arnold Kaplan. Dr. Arnold Kaplan is the scientist who created, who is, sorry, Dr. Arnold Kaplan is the scientist who is credited with discovering MSCs. I'll call them MSCs moving forward. So he is known as the father of mesenchymal stem cells. He is the professor of biology at Case Western University, Case Western Reserve University, and he is director of the Skeletal Research Center at the university. He actually proposes that they may be best termed medicinal signaling cells as opposed to mesenchymal stem cells. But if we use the two terms, they are interchangeable. MSCs provide growth factors that facilitate nerve cell growth, repair, and survival through compounds like VEGF, nerve growth factor, and brain-derived neurotrophic. MSCs address disordered T and B cell regulatory function. These are your white blood cells. And remember that they not only help you defend yourself against, say, viruses, bacteria, parasites, things like that, but that attack has to be regulated. If it's overly aggressive, for example, then you can end up with autoimmune diseases. So MSCs address disordered T and B cell regulatory function. MSCs increase microglial M2 phenotype by suppressing tumor necrosis factor and interleukin-1 beta. Well, your brain has its own immune cells, and sometimes those immune cells are protective, and at other times they're on attack. We need them to be on attack at the right times, but we don't want them to be on attack all of the time. And these cells can switch back and forth between their two states. MSCs increase the protective anti-inflammatory type of or form of microglia. MSCs increase anti-inflammatory chemical signals called cytokines. They deliver microRNA that regulate a wide variety of processes, involved in immune modulation and neuroprotection. And they are anti-apoptotic, meaning that they can stop or slow the process of programmed cell death.